Hello, everyone, and welcome to Dimes with Dara on the Joy Slot podcast brought to you by IrishSportsDaily.com. I am your host, Greg Flamong, and my co-host, as always, is Dara Mabry, who you can also see calling games on the ACC Network. You can see her doing sideline. You can see her doing color commentary, doing a great job. I'm going to talk to you about that, too. I didn't tell you that beforehand, but we are going to talk about that, and we're also going to talk about the latest in Notre Dame's women's basketball. They just finished a 4-0 stretch since the last time we talked to kind of solidify themselves in the ACC standings, in the ACC race as well for the regular season championship. Got a big game coming up against Syracuse next week, so we're going to talk about that as well. And where the ladies are trending, I think it's safe to say things are trending up, but there's still some things I think that need to be hashed out for them to be a serious threat in the ACC and in the NCAA tournament. So thank you very much for tuning into this show. If this is your first time catching us, or if you've caught us before and you haven't done so already, please subscribe to this channel. Please hit the like button and please hit the notification bell so whenever is we are going live. And we would like to thank one of our sponsors right up top, which is ESQ Clothing. And if you're looking to upgrade your wardrobe, ESQ has created the world's first bamboo dress shirt, crafted from high-quality bamboo fabric. It's the softest and most comfortable shirt you'll ever put on. Not only more sustainable than cotton, but also feels cooler, has stretch, is odor and wrinkle-resistant, and is even machine-washable. You've seen ESQ's one-piece collar bamboo dress shirt on all your favorite Notre Dame players and coaches, and it's the perfect shirt for your today's business meeting or heading for a night out. Use ISD15 and get 15% off all online items. That's ISD15 for 15% off. Dara, I recently saw you doing a basketball game. You did the Notre Dame ladies. You did their basketball game, and look, I told you, I don't know how to gauge my own bias in these situations, right?
Uh-huh. Yep.
I'm watching the show. Doing a great job, and I feel like it would be very hard for me to like come up with really good ideas for the opponent. And I think, was it Boston College who they
were? It was, yeah, BC.
And and you were like, listen, Boston College, they need to start getting the ball like in transition. They need to start like moving the ball, setting some screen. Like you had all these ideas for them, just picking up. And I was like, this is the point guard. Like she is running point right now for BC, but she can't be out there. So good job by you on that. I want to give you some flowers. tell me, how hard is it? Do you find calling games like that? Is it come natural for you to kind of get the flow of it and kind of see what needs to happen? Or is it just kind of a struggle? Like how is that for you?
Yeah. So my first time doing it, I was a little nervous because it was my first time. I was like, you know, I don't want to mess up like when I should speak or when I shouldn't speak. But it came natural. Like you would be surprised, believe it or not. Like even if someone who didn't want to go like into commentating, like in terms of when to speak and when not to, like it kind of is just like your basketball IQ at that point. So there's sometimes where I had to like hold back where there's things I want to say, but I can't say it, which is really fun. But like, I mean, it's great. I like color commentating better than sideline. Sideline, you have a couple quick hits and so much credibility all within 20 to 45 seconds, you know, which is great because you get to like get those big storylines, those personal storylines. But then like color commentating, you just get to sit and talk basketball, like, and put your two cents in. And like, especially when you're someone that played and did it. It's really easy for the play-by-play to pitch to you and ask you certain questions. So I was with Tyler, he was a student and he was great. So I would say color is definitely my favorite. I like it way better than sideline.
Another thing you're good at, or that I noticed you were good at, is like, I think sometimes if the play-by-play sends something to you, a lot of the time that the color person will feel like they need to interject kind of like a lot.
Right.
And there were a few occasions when you would give like, not like a one word answer, but like a one sentence answer.
Right. Yeah.
And it's like, it's not that deep. Like, oh,
it isn't.
Like, they just need to play better. Or that girl, just she needs to use a rebound better, you know? And then like, you could get him, and then he would keep going. And I thought that was really, like, it was you did a good job. Like, really good, like you say, basketball IQ. Like, really good, like, commentating IQ there. Just kind of. Right.
Yeah. I talked with a lot of people, like, before I went into it. One person in particular, Karen Keys. Obviously we love Karen, but yeah. she does the radio with Sean, and she has done a bunch of other games as the color commentator. And she kind of just said, like, you have to be able to paint a picture for people that might not understand. And sometimes like, you would think that if you dive deep in and like you really try to break it down and analyze it, like, you're going to lose somebody that doesn't really know the game that well. So that's why, like, when it comes down, like, it was the end of the game, I was like, BC just needs to take better shots at this point. Like, there's nothing else to it. And like, it's easier for people to understand.
Yeah, no, I mean, that's good. Right. And like, you're explaining the game and like, it doesn't need to be, you know, like this big complicated setting back screens, or they need to run certain sets or whatever. Like, no, their shot selection is poor and they need to take better shots. And when it comes from that, they're going to be more successful. So I just wanted to give you some credit right up front. Good job by you on that.
Thank you.
Feel very lucky to share this space with you. let's talk about the ladies. Like I said, 4-0. Over the last four, not the toughest of opponents, right? And I think the last time we spoke, you predicted this, right? Like, they're gonna catch their bearings here. You know, got Sony back, right? So she's been back for a little bit now. Got Maddy back from her little concussion situation. She's wearing a face mask, and that's kind of solidified things. What have you seen, just kind of broadly, in the last four games that's gone well for Notre Dame, and then kind of going forward, what they can build off of?
Things flow easier. So obviously when you have Sonia back, that's another person that you can run a lot more plays for. And then she can also shoot the ball really well. So it opens up more opportunities for Maddy inside. And then like, it's a domino effect. So there's more opportunities here than it. Kylie might be open more often. AD might have another look at those corner threes, which is great at this point in the year, because I mean, obviously, injury is not ideal at any point, but it's better that it happened now than down the line, because then other people got that experience early on, like AD, KK's had to play the one a lot. So just having that experience and that post presence and perimeter presence back makes the biggest difference in the world. Even just Sonia coming back, they looked like a completely different team. And now they have both pieces, Maddy and Sonia. It's just, especially Maddy on the inside, because you can also pull her out to the outside, but there's a lot of passing that goes on, like in our Notre Dame traditional offense. Like, you got to be a good passer at times to excel, and Maddie's created a ton more opportunities, not only for herself, but for everybody else too. And then Sonia, it's just, obviously, she comes in, she does everything. You already know what you're going to get from her, but the leadership, lead by example, like, even I think especially when teams go on runs, like runs the 5 games ago looked a lot worse than they do now with her on the floor. Because I feel like we just always have an answer with her out there.
Yeah. You talked about Maddy. I texted you. She's my favorite player on the team.
love Maddy.
She's great, you know, and she does so many little things that like really help. Like we talked about shot selection, I think, just a second ago regarding an opponent, BC, but just in terms of, like, we talked about it with the men too, like how they go long stretches where their shots are just not very good. They just don't get quality shots. And I think there was a play in the last game where I think that they had just hit a three. So the Notre Dame was up 15. They hit a three in the corner and crowd's kind of going crazy. You know, they were trying to get into the game. And Notre Dame kind of switches the ball around to Maddy, and she's behind the 3-point line, kind of at the wing, and she could take it, right? And you know, look, she's a good 3-point shooter, right? Or you know, it's part of her game, right? So she could go ahead and take that shot. She doesn't take the shot though. She puts the ball on the ground, and she drives baseline, and then she draws a defender over, and then she whips a pass left-handed, right, over to the corner. I think it was to Anna, who then swings it to Sony, who then swings it to Hannah, and then Hannah drives.
Talking about, yeah.
Yeah, so then Hannah drives, draws the and one, and so she gets the layup, she draws a foul, and then she, and that kind of just quells all the momentum there. And I'm like, man, this play was absolutely made by Maddy, putting the ball on the ground and drawing the defense and basically compromising their entire defensive structure. And right. like that won't show up in the stats, right? Like that's not a statistical play at all. But that's what she brings, right? Just the confidence to even put the ball on the ground there. Cause you know, you think she's driving to score. She ends up driving to pass and playmake for the team. And I think she brings that, right? And there's so much there where she can get the ball on the elbow, like we talked about, that was missing when she was out, get the ball at the free throw line and playmake from there. Or she has that little step back, right? Like she has a little step back floater that I think she's really good at. And so that just helps like so much, right? Like it just helps out. Helps right. out Sony. It helps out. Helps out Kylie, right? Like it needs, because then she can feed it inside to Kylie, and that really kind of benefits her too. So I think she's such an important player for Notre Dame. So very happy that she's back. Love the way she plays the game. And speaking of Sony, she's the 43rd player in Notre Dame history to score 1,000 points in a game. She did so against Virginia last week. She scored 28 on the night, 12 for 12 from the field. You know, just having her back is great. Like she was 3 for 6. I think it was 3 for 6 from the 3-point line in the last game. I got to check myself on that, but I know she was really hot from behind three in the last game there. She's starting to kind of get stronger, right, and find her way on the court. Where can they go now? Now that this is kind of the team, right? And I'm concerned about. You know, I just don't think they can count on Olivia coming back anytime soon. She hasn't been practicing. Cass is still in a boot, right? So that, I don't know the nature of that injury, but the fact that she's been in a boot for a while, that's not a good development. But where do you think things are going with this team and what they can do kind of as they build more chemistry together?
I think when you have a short group like that, you have to really embrace, like there's a saying in basketball, like do your role and do it well, you know? So you have tops 7. I don't think Neil has shown signs of going 8 unless it's like the scores run up in the third or the fourth, et cetera. And I think that you just have to understand, look, this is what I'm supposed to come in and do. And I have to do it well because it works in your favor, but it also won't work in your favor because it's like it with such a short group, if something is missing, it's so magnified, right? So like not having Sonia, so magnified. Everyone's just playing junk defense, not coming out on the 3-point line. You have to alternate everything that you're doing. It makes Hannah's job harder. KK's looking around like, oh, well, what the hell do I do now? Because now there's 3 people waiting for me in the paint, you know? And it's not saying that they can't create. It just makes it harder. And then it makes you go back and take the ball at the top of the key and run a late shot clock every time. And that becomes exhausting. And then it becomes hard to win. So if they can learn, okay, these are the pieces that we have. I have to come in and do my role and do it well, then they'll be fine. Because Notre Dame has shown history of having 7 players and winning a national championship. You know? So it's just they have to come together more, a collective understanding. And I would say on the flip side of that, they need a little more leadership. They need a little more than Hannah doing what Hannah does. I think vocally, and I think it could come from AD and Maddy. Because Sonia is lead by example. Sonia is like this on and off the court. She is no one other than herself. She's so reliable and she leads by example. But I think vocally, they kind of need just an older person to rally the group, calm them down, who's been in that situation before, that doesn't freak out and just say, look, A and B. It doesn't ever have to be A, B, and C because no one's attention span is like that. A and B, this is what we have to do, coming together. And I think that it's great that the adversity happened before ACC play, maybe in the beginning of ACC play, because I bet you if we were to sit down and talk with each and every one of them, they would tell us that they learned a ton over I guess five game span.
Yeah. Are you concerned at all about Hannah's workload? Let me give you some context to this question. So she's in the ACC now, just against ACC opponents. She's shooting 46% from the field, 36% from three, which is actually is pretty good, right? That'll work, especially for the right. type of scorer that she is. But she's got 34 assists, 28 turnovers, right? So that's a little more one to one than you kind of want there. And it isn't even anything against her. It's just a fact. Like, I guess the better question is, do they need to engage? Do they need to engage Sony as an initiator? You know, kind of more so to give a little bit less, because Hannah, I feel like is becoming the type of scorer where it's like, man, when she gets to the basket, like, she is so dangerous around the basket. Like, right. I feel like so much of her scoring right now is in the paint and attacking. And then there's the threes, like, but she's not shooting the threes at like a great clip at the moment. Right. So I just feel like, does she need a little bit less on her plate to kind of get the most out of her? Like, I feel like that's something that needs to kind of happen, but I was wondering your view on that.
I think that she lives up to what's on her plate. I don't think that the issues that we're discussing here regarding like the shooting percentage and the assist to turnover ratio are coming from like too much fatigue or workload. I think it's coming from shot selection and pace on her end, because we know she's going to play the whole game. We know she's going to get hers. We know what she's going to do every single time. I think we talked about it on the last podcast, like, just shot selection and decision-making at certain points in the game, because the ACC plays a different pace. And I think that's what they realized at Syracuse, is like, oh shit, it's go time now. You know, now it's real. It's ACC play. And you have to have a mindset of like, you're 0-0 every game, every opponent matters. And I think that, you know, the level of competition is a lot different. So she might have to do some adjusting when it comes to when teams go on their run. I think she needs to do a better job of, I feel like she feels pressure to make something happen right away, you know, and she'll dart to the basket and she'll throw up a shot and she might not get the foul call. And then in ACC play, that's a bucket on the other end, you know? Yeah. So I think maybe not necessarily like fatigue and workload and like, okay, maybe get someone else involved. Like, yeah, I think Sonia could come get the ball at the top of the key and just get the ball into the elbow and start the offense, you know? But I don't think like necessarily lowering Hannah's workload will help her. I think it's more like strategic, like, here's what to do when this happens or when they go on a run. And that's just something like Niel told me last week, that they watched the film together after every game. They watched the whole game together. And she asks her, you know, okay, what'd you see here? Like, and it's not like a, what the hell were you thinking here? Like, it's like a, no, I genuinely want to know what your thought process was, so then we can work together. And that's just growing pains as a freshman, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. And it's like, I don't think you use the word like she feels pressure. I think it's more like she wants it. Like, she wants the smoke. Like, she honestly might be like the most competitive athlete on Notre Dame's campus right now.
100%.
Like, just 100%. Fiery, just is about the smoke, you know? Like, she is about it. It's funny. Like, we were talking about Kobe before we started. Like, Kobe was like that.
Yeah.
And, like, he would get caught in situations where it's like, he was so competitive and like willing to, I want to be the one, like, oh, they're going on a run, I'm going to be the one to break it. Like, exactly. I'm going to do it, right? And I think Hannah's that way. Like, I think Hannah views it that way. Like, she's very willing to put the onus on herself, right?
100%.
Which, you know, I don't think anyone feels this way, because I think Hannah's Q rating is like 100 right now. But I think it could be construed as like, I don't want to say selfish, but just like, someone could say like, she's putting too much on herself, right? And I don't think that's what she's doing. What I'm saying is like, just strategically, like you said, like strategically. Giving her other ways to attack the defense.
Yeah.
Right. Instead of pounding the ball and just trying to kind of force getting to the basket. Right. Cause she gets in trouble that way, you know? And cause like, like you said, if that's a miss or if that's a turnover, you get compromised, you drive and it's not there, you try to kick out, you throw it to the other team, like that's going to be a bucket, like you said. So it's just kind of a lot of dangerous possessions. And then utilizing, like you said, like there's the leadership aspect, utilizing Sony in that way.
Yeah, agree.
Another way that, like, another thing that would just be great, just like would be awesome, you know, is if Anna just went through like a month where it's just like, I'm going to shoot 50% from three, you know, like that would just be good. You know? and it's like, can it happen? You know, it could, yeah. Right? It's just, I think that like good teams, they get that from like, hey, like you're shooting, you know, whatever it is she's shooting right now. I don't know what it is. It's not 50%. I'll tell you that. It's not 40%. But it's just like, hey, she could, right? She could just go a string of like games where it's like 2 for 4, 3 for 6, right? 3 for 7, something like that, where it just kind of heats up from three. And then that's just like a boost to everything, right? I think that would be great.
I think that would be fantastic too. I think that, and I've seen her like working on it a ton. She's a really hard worker. I think just a little bit of a quicker release.
Yeah.
Half a second, you know? Because I mean, she came from Fordham A-10, and like, this is not discrediting her basketball ability clearly, because she's starting for a Power 5 team now. But like, I think at this in the ACC, you have longer, faster, athletic, more athletic athletes, if that makes sense, than there is in the A-10. So I think just maybe half a second faster, she'll be more comfortable letting it go, you know, because I feel like sometimes she catches it in the corner and then it's like, oh no, well she's coming now. So now maybe I'll have to go into my pull up. But if she can just half a second, and like the only way to do that is to keep shooting them. So I'm confident she'll come along. But yeah, I need her to just break out one game and freaking bang like 5 threes. That's what I need from her.
Yeah. And just, you know, just everyone, not just her, right? Nat, right? Like Nat, stop fouling. Like you said, it's funny. Like, you said that to me, and the next game, she picked up like 2 fouls, and she couldn't play, right? And you kind of made that point, like, stop fouling. You got to stop. You can't. It's just too important. Yeah, it's too important. Right. You're too important to the team. And then Kylie, like, just it's in there. It's bring it out. Like it's got to be there. Mentioned before, big game upcoming against Syracuse. They're at the top of the standings right now. Notre Dame sitting fourth, but they've got some big games against teams that are ahead of them. What could be different now? Syracuse won the opening matchup. What could be different in this game versus the first one?
Take care of the ball and rebound.
Yeah,
that fourth quarter was nauseating to watch. I mean, that was offensive rebound into and one, into turnover, into contributed hitting a three in our face. I hope Deja Fair doesn't hit 2 threes over net. Once again, me and her have talked about this off the record. Hope she doesn't hit those threes in the fourth quarter. So just have to lock in more down the stretch, but take care of the ball early on. Like you can't, Syracuse is good. It didn't happen just against us. Like they beat a couple other teams, good teams. And they run that press and that zone, and you need to get the ball to the middle. Maddie's going to be huge in this game. She wasn't her best against Syracuse last time, but I think she learned a lot. So Maddie's a big piece. And you just have to rebound and take care of the ball. That's it. Like there was no like, oh, it was an off day for us. Like, no, you guys didn't do the two things that you needed to do to win. So you can't expect to win. So take care of the ball and rebound. It's that simple.
Yeah. How much does home court matter in this situation?
Oh, against them a lot specifically, because I'll tell you what, I cannot stand shooting at that place. It absolutely sucks. You let one go and depending on who you are, you're like, oh wow, the basket is a lot closer than it seems, or it's a lot further than it seems, just because you're playing inside of a football stadium with a basketball court put on it. So I know the Syracuse women are probably used to that, but I think when you play Syracuse specifically, home court advantage is so important just because of the depth perception in the in Carrier Dome.
Right. So basically the seats are further away.
There's no one behind those seats though. Like you have like court seats and then there's no fans behind them in the first or the second half. So it's like, oof, like it's rough, you know?
Mm-hmm. How do you feel like things are trending for not just Notre Dame in the conference, but the conference as a whole, right? Like how do you feel like that conference, the ACC, is trending right now?
I think it's gotten to the point where it's like you can't nail one champion yet. You know, yeah. Like in the past, it was ours. We were winning that thing every year. I don't have the records on paper right now, but like early on paper, you could say there was a clear ACC champion. And I think that's the beauty of it now is that like at this point in the year, from what we've seen, like going off of facts, like there's, I think, three teams that could win it. I think us, Virginia Tech, and NC State. I think I need to see like more growth out of North Carolina and Louisville specifically. But you couldn't say that in the past. You couldn't nail down three and be like, I think we have three potential ACC champions, mm-hmm. you know? And I think that's great because you go down the line, it goes for everybody else too. Like you can't not show up. Like every game is super important. And in the ACC, because you have great opponents, there's a lot more that factors in down the line. So it's not just like a win is not just a win, right? Because you have great teams in the conference now. If you beat Virginia by 8 and then NC State, even though you beat NC State, NC State turns around and blows them out in the standings later on, that matters. Yeah. Everything matters now because there's not one clear champion. There's 3, 4, 5. Like, you see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. So I'm looking at the standings. There's 6 teams that have two or less losses, right? No one's undefeated. So Syracuse 6-1, North Carolina 6-1, Louisville 5-1, Notre Dame 5-2, Tech Virginia Tech, I should say, 5-2, NC State 4-2, right?
Right.
Obviously, NC State's got a game to catch up on. Same with Louisville. So it's just like there's 6 teams there who are just kind of vying, you know, for a spot. And I mean, we kind of talked about it before. Like there was a lot of depth, and I think the fact that you know, Sony getting hurt. Maddy getting hurt when she did, like that kind of even things out a little bit, right? That North Carolina game, like that's really just like in hindsight, that's really frustrating. Like it's a frustrating loss to take.
Very.
Just felt like they were kind of in control of that game, and then they let it slip away in the fourth quarter. But look, it's going to be exciting, right? It makes for a lot of exciting basketball coming down the stretch. And I do like that Notre Dame is starting to pick up, right? Like they did get healthy at the right time. Obviously, it'd be better if you could get at least Cass back, right? But that remains unclear. Yeah, that remains unclear, right? Like I said, last we've seen her, she's still in a boot, right? No kind of update on that. But you got the big one against Syracuse on Thursday, so everyone's going to be looking towards that. So that's going to be very fun to watch. A bit of national something I wanted to touch on before we get going. Caitlin Clark got run into, or there was a collision between Caitlin Clark and a fan coming on the court. Listen, all right, like fans storm the court, right? That's not a new thing. But what was your take on that? Just the whole situation, if you have a take, if there's any sort of take.
I saw a couple angles of it, and my thing is like, from an athlete's perspective, when you lose in an environment like that, it absolutely sucks. And you are thinking of one thing only, and just getting back to that damn locker room, right?
Yeah.
And then fans per se, like I know I read one article that said like she was really apologetic, but like you have to be careful. Like you are darting on the court, not looking. And then you just so happened to not run into an athlete. You ran into Caitlin Clark. Like, come on. Like, you can't be doing that.
Yeah.
Then also, like, I felt like the whole thing was dragged a little bit. Like, she's okay. They unfortunately slammed into each other, but obviously it's magnified because it's Caitlin Clark. Yeah. And I think maybe both of them just needed just this much more awareness. That's it.
Yeah. I mean, I think, you know, look, if you're going on the court, right, you don't belong on the court. You're not supposed to be there. Now look at you have a big win like that. People storm the court.
Okay? Well, let's go back to that. Also, I thought Ohio State, it's like, I know you guys won, but like, it was a conference game. It doesn't take away anything. And like, this isn't to the women, it's to the fans. It's like, it's not the national championship.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it just doesn't have to be that way. My thing is, like, if you're entering the court, you can't run into a player.
And it can't be Caitlin Clark either.
You can't run into any player. Like, you just, you got to pay attention. Like, you can't, like, don't be running with your phone. Like, it, you know, like you're running out.
The fan was like that.
You got your phone up and it's like, I'm running on the court. I'm going to put it on my TikTok or whatever. Like, you can't do that. That can't happen. Right.
No.
And so that's kind of how I come out on it. It's just like you said, like, don't run into Caitlin Clark.
Don't run into anybody, but God.
It's not good. It's not good. It's not that big of a deal. She's fine. Everyone's okay. Whether the lady's apologetic afterwards or not, she definitely didn't stop. She definitely kept on going and didn't check or do anything like that. She just went back into the scrum. That's a bad job, Dara. That's not a good job by that lady. If you're going to run into someone, just check and just make sure, right? You did a dumb thing. Just check on it. That's all. That's all you got to do.
Yeah.
What are your next assignments, Dara? Where are we going to see you next?
My next assignments. I'm going to try my hardest to go to the UConn game.
So UConn is Sunday?
Saturday.
Saturday? Okay. So Thursday, Saturday they play?
Yes. Unfortunate. That's a quick turnaround. And it's at 8 p.m.
You hate that. These are student athletes. They're just student athletes. Treat them better than this.
That TV time, unfortunately.
But it's good. It's a good environment for them. It'll be a good experience.
Yeah.
So we'll see you there. You're gonna try to go to the game. When are you calling a game? Or when are you doing sideline or
Clemson? I'm calling Clemson February 22nd, 24th, or 26th. It's one of them. I can't tell you off the top of my head right now.
All right.
But yes, I will be on for Clemson.
All right. We'll look for you then. we'll be sure to do a show. We've got Syracuse and then we've got UConn. So we'll talk about how the ladies do after that. And we'll have another conversation as things start to really, kind of become clear with the Notre Dame women's basketball team. So, we can end it there. Thank you everyone for tuning in. If this is your first time catching us again, please subscribe, please like, please hit the notification bell. So, you know, whenever it is, we are going live, that little pup, he's reminding people like the show, put the pup up here.
He there says, like our show and tune in and get please your bamboo shirt.
Bamboo shirt. Get your from ESQ. Check it out.
He
approved this message. So, yeah, you're going to want to check him out. Thank you everyone for tuning in. We'll talk to you after the games. Keep getting them buckets.